Good evening. This is Nancy Flinchball with the City of Springfield and the Global Education of Peace Network. Tonight, we are delighted to have a presentation by the Hindu community of Springfield, presented by Dr. Ravi Khanna. This year, for our Global Education and Peace Network's 19th season, our theme is Connecting Through the Distance, Practicing Faith, Hope, and Love in Pandemic Times. Dr. Khanna will be talking about his Hindu tradition, and we will get to go on a wonderful virtual tour of the Dayton Hindu Temple. He also will explain how the Hindus have been practicing their faith during the pandemic, as well as responding to the crisis of racism in our country. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Ravi Khanna.
Okay, good. So, namaste, everybody, and namaste. Good evening. Allahu Abha. That's a Baha'i greeting. Shalom, Salaam Alaikum, Sat Sri Akal, and greetings to all from Hindu community of Springfield and Dayton. My name is Ravi Khanna, and on behalf of Hindu community of Springfield and Dayton, I thank Global Education and Peace Network to give us the opportunity to present the tour of Hindu Temple of Dayton and give you key aspects of Hindu faith and what Hinduism teaches about our current issues in society, like pandemic and racism going on. I will show you a few slides explaining Hinduism and a virtual tour of Hindu Temple of Dayton and the methods of worship in that. I will conclude with how Hinduism connects with pandemic and racism, and then we'll have some room for question and answers. I will start today's presentation with a video. So if we can turn that on.
Can you see the screen?
Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. So can
you? My men and boys to get it. In, you write this down because this is something we're going to be using every Sunday from now on. In, men, I need you to get it. Ladies, I want you to get it, but especially I want my men and boys to get it. N-A-M-A-S-T-E. That's a Hindu term. Namaste. Say that.
Namaste.
Say it again. Namaste, Jerome, means the divinity within me salutes the divinity within you. Y'all missed it. Namaste means the divinity within me salutes the divinity within you. Now, flag, this simply means I recognize that Bobby has some God in him. See, many of our boys don't have any respect for life. That's why it's so easy to kill them. So when I realize that Bobby got some God in him, just as I have some God in me, that will make me respect him not only physically, but I'll respect what I say about Bobby. We have not been taught to respect one another, so I need you to say it again, namaste.
Namaste.
Say it again, namaste. The divinity within me salutes the divinity. Any teaching going on here today? And maybe that's why we... To say that word over and over, I want men and women, young and old, to start greeting one another instead of saying, what's happening? Young folk, when you greet somebody, namaste.
Namaste.
Say it why?
Namaste.
Say it again.
Namaste.
What does that mean? The divinity within me salute. So don't tell me, what's happening, bro? Because that ain't kept our boys from killing one another. They've been saying it for a long time. What's happening, bro? Bam!
first slide of it.
Can you see the slide still?
Can you see the slide now?
No.
Okay, share.
The second will share again. Can you see them now?
Can you see the slide?
Yes.
Okay, good. All right. So what you just saw was a video by an African-American pastor who talked about namaste. So namaste is a Hindu greeting, which means I salute or bow down to the divinity within you. Everybody has divinity within themselves, and this is how we greet. So if we see divinity in everybody, then is there any room for bias or prejudice? Of course, the answer is no. So that is the Hinduism take on any form of discrimination on the basis of color, caste, creed, faith, gender, ethnicity. So there should be no discrimination on these bases. So namaste is also pandemic friendly because we are just bowing and folding our hands from a distance. All right, next slide. That's good. Okay, can you see the slide now? What is Hinduism? Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. So Hinduism teaches that we are spiritual beings in a human body having a human experience. So Hinduism teaches mutual respect for all living beings and creation. And Hinduism also teaches pluralism, which means a Sanskrit term called Ekam Sat Vipra Bahudha Vadanti, which means that God, Brahman, or truth is one, but many ways or many paths to reach that and experience that divinity within yourself. There is many ways to express that experience also. Actually, Hinduism is a form of spiritual democracy. We, you know, used to say there are 33 million gods and goddesses that, you know, Hindus pray to. God is only one. These are the attributes, that there are many attributes of God that we see either formless or in form. So those gods and goddesses that Hindus pray in their temple or at home, these are just the attributes. These are divine attributes that you give a form that you can connect to. So if it's up to Hindus, you can have 7 billion gods and goddesses. So you can also pray to any form that in nature, you know, in addition to other forms. So there is an opportunity for all of us to experience that divinity in oneself, which is the ultimate goal of human birth. And that comes with dharma. And it comes by removing the ignorance that we have, which is the that we don't see that divinity. That is the ignorance which prevents us from seeing God within us. Let's go to the next slide. So further down, if I would say, many Hindus, if you ask them, oh, what is Hinduism? They'll say, oh, it's a Hinduism is a way of life, or it's a philosophy of living a life of dharma. And that's the Vedantic philosophy, which is most popular in, you know, Hindu system. So many Hindus say it is not a blind belief system. There's no dogmas or rules. You can question everything and anything till you understand and get your answers from your guru. So in a way, Hinduism is also scientific. So follow your dharma, and even before you can recognize or experience the divinity within you, you will get some benefits. And what those benefits are, you can live a stress-free life. You can have happiness always, eternal bliss, and freedom from sorrows. So Hinduism also called Sanatan Dharma. What does that mean? Sanatan means eternal religion, and it was always there and will always be there. So it's eternal. And you heard this word dharma now 2-3 times from me. What does that really mean? Dharma is righteous way of living with moral and ethical conduct. So, but dharma also means the law of being. What does that mean? Dharma indicates essential nature of anything without which it cannot retain its independent existence. These are the eternal principles that uphold the universe. So now if you ask me, for example, I will give you dharma is the sun, dharma of sun, you know, sunlight you see every day is heat and light. So sun is always warm and light. You can never have a cold, dark sun, right? So dharma of sun is heat and light. What is dharma of sugar? That is sweetness. You cannot have a bitter sugar. You have sugar means sweetness. The dharma of water is wetness. So on and so forth. So everything in existence has its dharma. So what is the dharma of human beings? And that is Atman or divinity within us, which we cannot, without which we cannot exist. So that's the life spark which keeps us from to keep us alive and functional. So we must abide in dharma if we want to see that divinity or experience that divinity within us. That is the biggest lesson from one of our scriptures called Bhagavad Gita. If you heard about that, it has 700 verses, but it starts with dharma and ends with mama. Mama dharma means my dharma. So we have dharma to abide in. And I'll tell you a little bit more about it in the next slide. Now, a little bit about the scriptures. Now, Mahavakyas is just a sentence, four great sentences that I put down here. These are the truths that were described in four Vedas. We actually have Vedas as our holy scriptures, but then there is a library of Hindu scriptures. It's not one Bible or one book, it's so many. But Vedas are the ancient and most popular. When the rishis and sages of past, they experienced this divinity by going into meditation and experiencing that. And they passed this experience through oral traditions from one generation to the next to the next. And finally, 5,000 years ago, it got written in the form of Vedas into four books. And all of them, if you look at these, the English meaning of each Sanskrit sentence, Prajnanam Brahman means consciousness is Brahman. The next, number two, the self or Atman is Brahman. And the third, Tattvam Asi, you are that, means you are Brahman. And the fourth one from Yajurveda is Aham Brahmasmi, which is I am Brahman. We are the existence, consciousness, bliss, which we call Sat Chit Anand. But unfortunately, we don't see that because we identify with body all the time and mind. So our journey is to uncover that experience. So next I will show you the video tour of our temple. And during that, you will also hear some of these words and some description of what Hinduism is all about and what we do in the temple and how we pray. So we'll play that video now.
So just a second, we'll share the video.
I have a technical person on my hand, otherwise I won't be able to run this show. Sorry about that. Okay, can you see the screen?
No.
Can you see? Okay, can you hear?
Yes.
Okay, good. This is a 15-minute video, so please listen and write down any question that come to your mind.
We cannot hear.
Okay, let's see, we'll share again.
We can hear the music, but not his words.
Sure. Just a second.
Okay, I was.
Raviji, you may want to play the local video file that you have. That may be quicker.
Okay.
Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Can you hear?
Yes.
Jai Shri Ram. Namaste and hello. My name is Anand Sharma, and today I'm going to be going over this beautiful and magnificent temple right behind me, also known as the Hindu Temple of Dayton, as well as go over the spiritual beliefs of our culture, Hinduism. Though I am 21 years old, I can assure you that I have a pretty good knowledge about Hinduism, and that's all thanks to my father, Pandit Ashwini Kumarji, who actually is a priest at this temple. Now, before I continue, I would like to take this time to thank the HCO board, as well as the other priests here at the temple, Pandit Ramesh Rajamani, for providing me with this opportunity to share my knowledge with all of you. The temple was established in the early 80s as a permanent venue for Hindus in Dayton. It encouraged congregation for worship, which allowed people to learn more about the concept of religion and culture. As a matter of fact, the temple aims to promote positive interactions, harmony, and spiritual growth within our community. For those who are watching, let us slowly fold our hands together and repeat the word Om slowly together while closing our eyes. Every time you say Om, I want you to envision something that makes you happy, something that makes you feel like you. Each time you say Om, feel more connected to Brahma, also known as our creator. Let us begin. Sacred symbol in Hinduism. It is the universal vibration and sound chanted before yoga and meditation practice. It is a manifestation of consciousness. Om represents the consciousness and divinity from within, which is present in our three states of existence: the awakening stage, the dreamer stage, and deep sleep. When we say Om, we feel peace in our heart, mind, body, speech, and cosmos. Om represents our creator, Sat Chit Anand. Sat is truth, Chit is conscious, and Anand is joy. So when we say Om, we speak the truth. And when we speak the truth, we feel more conscious and more aware. And when we feel conscious, that is when we experience true happiness. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is when you feel most connected to Brahma from within. You want to take a look inside? Come on. Wow. Isn't the temple beautiful? Please, take a look for yourself. Hinduism, known as Sanatan Dharma, or Eternal Way, is our planet's original and oldest living religion. It's the third largest religion in the world. But did you know that Hinduism never had a single human founder? It's simply a religion that helps a devotee search for truth from within. Many sages of India during meditation experienced divinity within themselves, And they were able to pass on this knowledge through oral tradition approximately 5,000 years ago as holy scriptures called Vedas. Now, you're probably wondering what that bell above me is all about, right? Well, when we walk into a temple, we typically ring the bell to emit a very beautiful ringing sound that echoes throughout the room. It alerts our consciousness that we have entered a very holy place. It brings the left and right parts of our brain into unity. It touches the seven chakras within our body, the energy centers within us, in which matter and consciousness meet. And that is emphasized in yoga and meditation. Oh, that reminds me. For example,
Ganana Mtra Ganapati Gum Havamahe Kavim Kabinam Upamasravastavam Sunmanti Devi Savi Vedi Sam.
As you can see, when we fold our hands and say Namaste, we are bowing down to our Creator, which is also known as Shastang Pranam. This means surrendering my ego in front of the deity, and in respect for elders. Now, a Hindu lives his or her life according to four Purushatra. Purushatra, the pursuits and goals of human life. Dharma, duties that includes righteous and ethical conduct. Artha, earning wealth, name, and fame, which falls into accordance with Dharma. Kama, fulfilling desires, also falling in harmony with Dharma. Moksha, complete liberation, and this is the ultimate goal, to reach the pinnacle of consciousness where living being and Brahma are one. Now at this moment, the two priests are conducting a puja, or a religious chanting, offering their sincere prayers to Brahma himself. We are also praying that Brahma will grant us the power to serve humanity for the rest of our lives. Including these rituals, there are many other reasons why people go to the Hindu temple. Individualized prayers, group chanting and prayers, special pujas on special occasions and festivals, and sometimes sit in silence to pray and meditate, which allows them to dwell within their inner worlds of consciousness. Now, most people have a very linear approach when it comes to time. Hinduism believes that the concept of time is cyclical. It's a continuous circle in which life begins to end and ends to begin. Time is a manifestation of Brahma. He's beyond time and space. He's omniscient, omnipotent, and omnipresent. All-knowing, all-powerful, and all-present. Now, since Hinduism believes that time is cyclical, this explains why we believe in reincarnation. It's the idea that people go through the cycle of life through multiple lifetimes. That is why it's important to live a happy and cheerful life, because that determines your wheel of destiny. Your wheel determines what kind of life you have in your next rebirth. Now, some of you might be wondering, well, how long do you keep reincarnating for? Well, as previously mentioned, our ultimate goal is to attain moksha, or salvation. This is when self-realization occurs, where one has lived a life that finds unity with our Creator, who can finally find freedom from the cycle of rebirth. Now, another question you could be asking is, how can I attain self-realization? Simple. Ask yourself the question, who am I? Hindu Dharma teaches various methods to reach the ultimate goal of moksha. Being a good human, which includes having qualities like compassion, friendliness, truthfulness, and absence of anger, greed, attachments, and pride. Having the constant desire of being one with Brahma. Having unpretentious, selfless service. Our beliefs determine our thoughts and attitudes about life, which in turn direct our actions. And our actions must serve the purpose for the good of humanity. This is otherwise known as Karma Yoga. or selfless service, and having a passion for knowing the truth. To understand Hinduism, one must understand two important philosophical points of view. The first one, the philosophy of universal truth. This truth of total inclusion of everything in the cosmos, including me standing on this earth. To understand this truth, one has to be willing to look within themselves and connect the dots externally. By doing so, very few people can stretch their mind to understand this divine abstract, which does not require rituals or deity. This philosophy of insight and experience uses the guidelines of the ancient texts called the Vedas and the Upanishads, which was compiled by the greatest philosophers the world had ever seen several thousands of years ago. The second point of view is the philosophy of manifestation. In this context, people see divinity in the form of a specific deity with certain attributes. As a result, several forms of deities and rituals have become an integral part of Hindu way of living. This beautiful temple in Dayton provides a platform for such an experience of divinity within us. Here we have Lord Ganeshji, the remover of obstacles. He helps one reach their aspirations in a timely and self-assuring manner. And if anything gets in the way, Lord Ganeshji will make sure to hold your hand and jump over the hurdle with you. Because no one deserves to go through a challenge alone. Follow me. Here we have Lord Ramji, form of Dharma. He is an incarnation of God in human form who provided knowledge about Dharma. And his life is still even relevant to us today. Lord Krishnaji symbolizes compassion, love, and tenderness. Besides him is Sri Dadaji. Their unity represents their ideal relationship that every human desires in his or her life. Lord Krishna is known to make people smile with his melodious flute tune. He was an incarnation of God in human form who re-established Dharma in a weakening society and resolved the conflicts of Arjuna, which has been transcribed in the Bhagavad Gita. And this is still relevant to us even today. And here we have the Holy Trinity, Brahma, Vishnu, and Mahesh. Brahma, the creator with his consort Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge. You cannot create anything without knowledge. Vishnu, the preserver with his consort Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth. You cannot preserve anything without the help of finance. And Mahesh, god of the solution, with his consort Parvati, the goddess of power. You cannot have a fresh start without having the power to destroy evil. Let us all just take a moment to reflect and think about all the things that we are grateful for. All the things that the Supreme Almighty has given us. Everything that has occurred in our life has somehow shaped us to who we are today, and we need to be grateful for that. Let us all take a moment to offer our sincere prayers to Brahma and just say thank you. Join me. Thank you. Well, there you have it. Hinduism is a beautiful religion with many values. The Hindu Temple of Dayton provides an insight into the Indian culture, which could be a great way to find spiritual connection with oneself. Hinduism teaches you about truth, love, and divinity, while ensuring that you stay true to the people around you, as well as stay true to yourself. Thank you for watching. Jai Shri Ram. Glory to God. Until next time.
Okay, so I hope you enjoyed the video tour of our temple. And while we get the slides back on, and hope you have some questions. I think we made the Hinduism clear like a crystal for you. I'm still trying to understand myself, but I hope you have some questions that we'll be able to answer in the Q&A. I have four more slides to conclude the talk for today. Let's go to the next one. No, next slide. Keep going. Okay. So you heard these terms. So I'm just going to go over these terms that you heard again and again. Namaste, you have all understood that it's we're seeing the divinity everywhere. And so that's what we greet each other with. Om is the sacred symbol of Brahman or God that you saw. And he described it very well also. We talked about Vasudev Kutumbakam, the whole world is one family. So Hindus believe that we are all the children of God. So there should be no discrimination for any reason. Ekam Sat Vipra Bahudha Vadanti, the God, there's only one God. And in philosophy, in religion, they call God, in philosophy is called truth. So that is only one. But many paths to reach that same goal. That is why Hinduism is considered pluralistic. It's not polytheistic, it's pluralistic. And God, the creator, is formless or can be with forms. So it doesn't matter. You know, you may see 100 deities and murtis, but it's all attributes of the same formless Brahman. And we talked about the God is omnipresent, omniscient, and omnipotent. And that's, I think, is in other religions also, it's felt that way. And so there is no my God or your God. God is only one and same God for all of us. The next slide it shows the methods that we use, you know, or the methods that are prescribed for us, how to get to that divinity. So these are the four human pursuits, or we call them purusharthas. Dharma is the most important aspect of that. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha. And he did mention in his talk, Anand, he's the son of our priest and has kind of grown in the temple for 21 years that he's, so that's why he knows quite a bit. And so the goal for a Hindu is to follow dharma while doing artha. Artha means earning wealth and name, fame, power, all of that. And kama is fulfilling desires, while the ultimate goal is moksha, the liberation from cycle of life and death. And various methods are available. Four methods that are more popular that are described is bhakti, which means devotion or surrendering to God. Karma is selfless service, and gyan is the knowledge. So the knowledge that we are the divinity, not this body or mind, which we kind of live in our day-to-day life. So it comes with practice and a lot of practice, I will say. Raj yoga or meditation, that is where the yoga, meditation, and there are many paths to get there. So meditation is very important in a Hindu's life. Then we go through various dharmas during our ashram. It's called, you know, there's a student life, married life, retired life, sannyasa or renunciate, which is also, we have special dharmas for each stage of our life. And The other thing that I mentioned before, and you heard, karma. Karma is, as you sow, so shall you reap. So that is quite obvious to all of us, that whatever we do, we have to pay for that. If we do good things, we gain merits. If we do bad things, we gain demerits. So we have to pay for that. He also talked about the cyclic nature of creation and time and the reincarnation. So that's one thing good that Hindus have, you know, multiple chances to achieve that goal. If not in this life, in the next life. So that's why most Hindus are very happy. So they are not fearful that, okay, you know, I have to do something in this life only. So they say, okay, if I'm not done spiritually getting there, I will, you know, be in that life. And you start right where you end this life. So it is, the life is continuous that way. So you really don't die. It's the body and the mind, you know, which have the death. Okay, so now let's see what is the connection of pandemic and racism with all what you heard about Hinduism. So if we follow dharma, there should be no problem in handling any form of crisis, situation, stress in life. And how does that happen? So you know, we should be preventing catching any infection, whether it's corona or flu or anything else in life, and build your immunity. How do you do that? By following the, first you follow the scientific rules that are given, you know, wear your mask, you know, wash your hands, do social distancing, and stay positive, exercise, smile, and laugh as often as you can. That builds up your immunity also. There are Ayurvedic principles. So I'm a medical doctor, but last year or two, I've been studying some Ayurveda, which is the ancient medical science from India. And that talks about herbs and spices and many natural things which help us live a more healthier life. So there are things described in that. Then caring for the body and also the mind. How do you care for the mind? Mind is our biggest problem. You know, because of this corona, a lot of people are going through anxiety, panic, fear. Some of that is genuinely because of losing a job or getting sick and all that. But for that also, there is an answer with yoga and meditation. You, there is a almost like a pandemic of depression, you know, due to what's going on. But that's the answer that, you know, the Hindus have through the scripture teaching. Hinduism is also very big on charity and compassion. And, you know, you do service, donation, you know, give wealth. You know, actually, my father used to tell when I was growing up, you know, do your seva or charity with tan, man, and dhan. Tan means body, man means mind, and dhan means your wealth. So give wealth if you have, for the needy, for food, for masks, and for the healthcare workers. So wherever you can, it should be done. And do with the body, if you can go and be volunteering at places where they need you, that is something you should. And also with man, by doing, you can pray for people who are sick and do meditation and, you know, think of their welfare and well-being. So by doing that, you can live a stress-free life and stay happy. I will give you an example of at personal level in the last 6 months since the lockdown happened. Actually, it has been a blessing for me. I have utilized this lockdown time for gaining more knowledge and skills. I learned Zoom, I didn't know anything about, and I'm playing Zoom on regular basis because we are attending many prayers and Zoom activities through the temple. So temple is closed for regular visits, but we are still doing the lot of pujas and prayers through the Zoom activities. And we have attended many yoga and meditation courses and webinars, seminars, and many guided meditation sessions. and some Ayurvedic medicine sessions, and to learn the lessons on improving our immunity. You saw that in the video also, there was people were walking around the temple. That was because in Hindu temple, for the last 6 months, people have been chanting for the welfare and well-being of all people affected and for the general health of the society. And they did it 10 million times in the last six times. So the chanting was done 10 million times. And finally, on the conclusion of that, this special service was done where people were going around the temple and chanting shlokas. And lastly, the last slide, let's go to that one. Okay, so as far as the racism is concerned, I mean, it's no brainer, we've talked about it. Vasudeva Kutumbakam, we talked about that the whole universe is one family. So if the whole world is one family, how can we discriminate against anybody, our own family, whether we are black, white, yellow, or brown? We should look at each person as a god. So right now, I don't know how many people are in the windows. So every window, I can see a god within you. So this is how the Hindu mind should think and look at. Ekam sat vipra bahudha vadanti. One truth and many ways to reach. So it does not matter that whether you are in this religion, that religion, so respect all for who they are. No need to convert anybody. Just acceptance and mutual respect is the most important part. And that is what we call the pluralistic aspect of Hindu. So I will end my talk right here and open it for any questions or if you have. So let's unmute everybody.
There is, Ravi, there's one question in the chat. When okay. Someone from Cheryl Dover, when someone is reincarnated, do you ever recognize them as someone you knew in a former life?
Yes, very good question. The question is wonderful, and people have asked that question. The answer to that is most people do not remember their past lives, because if you keep remembering, if you have gone through 10, 20, 30, 100 lives, you will be totally chaotic and confused, you know, so it is very hard. However, there have been case reports where kids have been able to recognize if they are taken to the places or they have remembered some things from their past life. And that is one of the reasons we always say, you know, the prodigies, the somebody who can play piano at age five or you know, chant something at age, you know, early ages. So they came prepared from their past lives. And okay, so we have some little sharing issue here. So we're gonna stop sharing. Okay, go ahead. Yep, you can do that. Okay, now I can see everybody. I could not see everybody before. So anyway, so the answer to that is, yes, some people can remember their past lives, but mostly it's not. Does that answer, Cheryl? Okay, you can unmute yourself to talk.
I just gonna say that I know that children sometimes have experiences like my daughter, when she was like four or five, she would mention things that happened a long, 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 long time ago, and she wasn't here, you know. Mm-hmm. So I just wondered about that. A lot of times with small children, they do come up with things that you can't understand.
Right. So that kind of proves there are books written on reincarnation theory. And in fact, I was recently watching a neurosurgeon, you know, American neurosurgeon. He was talking about his experience. He was in a coma and he went through ventilator and everything, but he survived. So those who kind of went to the next life and then came back, we have some experiences like that. But yeah, what your granddaughter is saying that is that that's a lot of things have been mentioned and written about too. Yes.
Thank you.
I'm also happy that I have a lot of our friends here. I see Dr. Vemana in one window. So if I can't answer any question, he's there to answer. He's my guru. All right. And Dr. Chadda is there. I see him too. All right. Go ahead. Any other questions?
My only question.
I really enjoyed the way they explained, you know, meditation on the video. Mm-hmm. And it seems like, you know, your understanding of meditation and the Hindu tradition is very similar to the way I meditate, you know, when I feel like I encounter God in the silence. Mm-hmm. And it seems like the description of Om is very a sense of a consciousness within creation of God. Would you describe it that way?
Yes, because I mean, basically, you know, the meditation is nothing but getting into a thoughtless stage, you know, eventually. And that is when you experience the consciousness within you. And that is what meditation, you know, gives you that experience. Now, we have been actually, Vinita and I have been doing meditation for the past few weeks, a guided meditation by Swami Sri Ravi Shankar. And he started a 21-day program in which on day one, he described what meditation is, what it should be. And then slowly he builds up that over a 21-day period as to the various stages of what we go through. You know, because when you sit with your eyes closed, first thing is your mind runs here, there, and everywhere. And it's very hard. And so, but he takes you along with that. So we have a Ravi Shankar in Springfield also. I'm talking about a different Ravi Shankar who has this meditation program. All right.
Nancy, it's very beautiful. You have to try it, you know. It's a guided, he tells you what to do, and it's beautiful.
Vinita can send you a link for that if you're interested, yeah.
I know you, when you went to India the last time, I know you told me you were going to do the Ayurveda.
Yes, I did. Yeah.
Ashram or retreat. Can you explain a little more about what that was like with the natural healing and the...
Right. Well, so Ayurveda, you know, I had heard about Ayurveda, but because I'm a medical doctor, so I went into more allopathic. And I always had interest because it's like, you know, when you're sick, your grandmother gives you hot water with salt in it, tells you to do gargles or put some turmeric in it or put some ginger and few other things. And so those are alkalinizing. They have, you know, immune enhancing function. So I learned some of that over there because I asked a lot of questions, you know, how do these spices, you know, they work in our body? And so so there is a scientific basis behind that. And so Ayurveda works in more as a prevention medicine, because if you're going to have fracture, then you can't fix that by doing meditation. You have to go to the hospital and get that fixed. However, for most illnesses in early stages or to prevent, you do you know, Ayurveda is very good. So I had that experience. They give you all kind of a special diet and then special spices, what to eat, what not to eat. Actually, they recognize that, you know, we have certain what we call doshas, you know, that personality types that we have, you know, some of us are very fiery people, you know, like type A, type B personalities. So something similar in the Ayurvedic medicine, they kind of divide you into that and then give you accordingly. So if there's an imbalance of those personalities, that is when you get sick. So if you can keep that in balance, then you're good. So that's the general principle of that.
I can add to this that when we first went there, there was a doctor, Ayurvedic doctor, who examined us with the help of our nerve, some Ravi, right? Some pulse, some nerve.
No, the pulse. They check your radial pulse, and that's how they can tell what kind of doshas you have. So it's a very advanced science in a way, but remarkable. It's worth experiencing if you, because we have Ayurvedic centers even here now. You know, so if somebody is interested, that's something you can go and experience.
They give you medicine, they give you special diet, they do yoga and meditation with you. So it's really a whole...
And massage, yeah. One of the things is they also do like all kind of different massages, you know, they're specifically prescribed for whatever type of problem you may have. So
we felt like $1 million when we came back.
You know, I still feel like $1 million. Any other questions?
It is preventive, but there are some actually, some treatments too.
Yes.
With the help of those. Yeah.
You're right. Shashi's right. Yeah. But you know, like in very advanced stages, it may not work, but you know, of cancer or something, but yeah. In many illnesses, it will work even in moderately advanced stages of the disease. Yes. Diabetes, hypertension, and heart disease, all of that can be treated by Ayurvedic principles. Yes.
Are there very many Hindus in the world right now? Is it a very popular?
1 billion. Right now, it's the third largest religion in the world right now. So 1 billion, 90% of which live in India, and the 10%. All over the world. Now in America, there are about between 3 and 4 million right now.
Okay. How often do you all meet? Do you meet every once a week, like Sunday? Like that's how they do at my church, a Christian church. Do you meet once a week or, you know, pre-COVID?
Pre-COVID, we have special pujas and the things going on that are announced in the Mandirvani or our like newsletter or bulletin. And so those who are interested, just like I said, it's a very democratic religion. So you go when, if there's a Krishna function going on, those who are Krishna Bhagat, they will go, you know, to attend that. Those who are Rama Bhagat, they will go to that. Vishnu, Shiva, all kind of ceremonies are happening in the temple on a regular basis. So a collection of people will go there to do the puja. We also meet, I'm part of actually Bhagavad Gita studies. You know, we do that. So like you have Bible study, so we have Gita study groups and people join once a week or more or less, depending on, you know, time they have. And then we attend those sessions and go through the scripture and see how it applies to our life on a regular basis. So that's what we do.
I know you have diet restrictions. Are those diet restrictions across the board for everyone in your faith, or is it?
No, the faith does not tell you what to eat or what not to eat, but majority of Indians are vegetarians. So 50% of Indians, Hindus mostly there are, you know, vegetarians, so they don't eat meat for various reasons. You know, one is ahimsa, you know, non-violence. So if you don't want to kill animals, so that's one main reason. But there are other reasons also. Maybe Dr. Chadda can answer. He's an expert in that. Dr. Chadda, you want to talk about the answer Cheryl's question?
No. I think they. Vegetarian food generally is considered plant-based food. It's considered more healthy in general anyway. Am I on? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Although, as you have said, it is, I shouldn't say that much, but I would say there is some cruelty to animals in eating meat. And so some people who have seen those videos by the vegetarian societies, from inside those
glass walls,
you know, those slaughterhouses, that becomes kind of a point that let's get away from as much as from meat. Plus, I think there is environmental factor. It requires more energy to produce 1 pound of meat, about 50 times more energy to produce 1 pound of meat than 1 pound of any vegetables. So there are various factors for that. So I think there are environmental factors, there are ethical factors, plus some people are from religious point of view. But in general, medically too, the plant-based food is healthier than animal-based.
Thank you.
I have a question. What is the Hindu concept of evil? It's a hard concept for any religion, but...
Yes, the evil happens at the body and mind level. You know, the divinity is pure and totally, you know, evil. I mean, that God is almighty, it's, you know, pure, purity, loving, kind, compassionate. So that's how God is described, all those attributes. When we talk about evil, that is happening at the body, mind, and that level. And that is, again, our creation. So that's where the karma theory comes, you know. So even at the thought level, if we think bad for somebody, that means we are doing some, you know, evil action that way. So that's what evil, how we you know, talk about. Maybe Dr. Vemana, you have any further to add to that?
Please unmute yourself.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
You know, in general, if you look at the world, everybody has some evil in their heart. Even serial killers who are mostly evil-minded, so they go home and take care of their family. They love their children. And all of us have some portion of that in a little bit. It depends upon the personality. So in order to find the divinity, which is inside of you, you have to conquer the evil side of you. I don't think there is anything completely evil or completely kind in the humans. So that's where the diet comes into the picture. You know, in the ancient India, the diet is divided by its influence on the mind. If you want to be a spiritual pursuit, they recommend a certain diet. For the warriors, they recommend a certain diet. So to get over the evil, that is what is called practice of yoga. Practice means sadhana, you know. So getting over the whatever little evil anybody has, which everybody has some portion, getting over that, becoming good. And also, in the, you know, the strictly speaking, the pure divine is beyond the good and evil. So to get there, you also have to get rid of the evil, and also good side becomes completely pure. You know, it's not easy to understand, but that means basically you have to, when you want to become a perfect, you have to get rid of everything in your system, good, evil, everything. I don't think I can be clear to you in the short term like that. Yeah. I don't know how much people understand.
I recently heard a Swami, he's talking about, you know, Swamis are our very highly evolved spiritual people. And he was talking about the sin as the ignorance that we have. See, once we recognize that we are divine, that the sin will go away. And when we say, oh, we are sinners, and that is, again, being ignorant. So that's how he was describing, even for, you know, Christianity also, that he was mentioning in that way, that it's not really that you're doing some evil action right now, but this is the ignorance that you are divine, you have divinity everywhere. So that's how he was describing. Anybody else?
Raviji, I may add something to the question.
Yes, please. I want to welcome and introduce. We have two board members here. I saw Mr. Ajay Jindal, and this is Arun Agarwal, who is going
Namaste. Namaste to everyone. Sorry, I lost my connection, Raviji, for a while. So I connected again. Okay. So I may have missed some part of the conversation. But going back to that evil question, that question obviously gets asked many times, and my son also he obviously, when we migrated to this country, he was 10 years old when we came here in 2001, We have twin boys, actually. And I was teaching him the same thing. And he basically asked me the same question that you are telling me, that namaste means divinity in me salutes your divinity. So that means our true nature is divinity. But then my body and mind is not my true identity. So his question was that, so that means if I, as at the body and the mind level, if I do some crime or something, it is okay. I should be able to do evil things, but still get away with it because that is happening at the body and the mind level. I'm divine. My nature is divinity. How do you reconcile that? And my son basically has a typical way of expressing his question. He just always says, so what? So after I gave him this 2 hours of lecture, so he said, Dad, but so what? I mean, you taught me all about this divinity and body and mind and my true nature and all that. But then that means you're telling me that I can be evil at my body and mind level and still get away with it. So I hope I'm able to relate to your question. And then the answer to that is, I had to do a lot of research too to really get to that reasonable answer. Because as Raviji was saying in the beginning, Hinduism is very scientific. There is nothing based on faith. I just could not have shut my son up by saying, no, I'm your dad and you have to hear me out, right? So basically, the answer to that, the only reasonable answer I could find for my son about this evil and being good at the divinity level and being evil at the body and the mind level is that if you truly identify your nature as divinity, as that Atman or Brahman, I do not know if we discussed those terms or not, but Brahman, Atman, consciousness, supreme consciousness, Satchit Anand, that's our true nature. So once we kind of identify with that true nature of ourselves, actually we become more strong, because that's an unchanging, never born, never dying element of our being. And once we kind of realize that nature, and once we kind of get identified with that nature, we only become strong. And then the tendency of becoming criminal or evil or doing bad things only happens when you are weak. Not that I'm trying to put down, the evil down or anything, or criminal people down or anything. But if you think about it, when you are feeling happy, contented, or strong, what is the likelihood that you will actually do something evil? At that time, you will actually be more joyous. You will want to even spread your joy among others. That's the state of mind which basically Hinduism tries to identify, and you that's a liberation. That's a freedom of suffering. I mean, Raviji talked about in the initial slide, the freedom from suffering. And my son asked me that question again, one more time. He challenged me on the top of evil. I'm distracting a little bit, but he did ask me, so what? You are saying that freedom, Hinduism gives me freedom from suffering, but at body and mind level, I'm still suffering. My brother treats me like shit. Please pardon my words. And my boss gives me hard time at times. And sometimes I feel more tired than I should be. I don't feel that enthusiastic. So I'm feeling bad. I'm suffering at body and mind level. But how are you telling me that this whole Hinduism gives me freedom from suffering? But that's a separate discussion to have had. I don't want to mix it with your question about the evil. So the evil, basically, as Raviji said, and Mr. Dr. Vemana said, but the evil actually happens at our body and mind level, but truly identifying your nature with that divinity, with that Brahman and Atman, you will actually become more strong, and that evil will disappear. You will never do anything evil. As a matter of fact, you will do more humanity work. You'll become more peaceful. If you look at all the spiritual leaders, and doesn't matter whether it is Hindu spiritual leaders or all the saints, the kind of capacity they have to do, I mean, you know, the kind of hospitals they open, the kind of orphanage they open, the kind of meditation and yoga centers they open to spread happiness and everything, the kind of achievements these spiritual leaders do, they achieve in their lifetime with the same resources as compared to what we do in our life, is not even comparable. And what's the secret of doing that, right? Because they have identified themselves with their true divine nature. And then with that, they become peaceful, they become contented. And then it's a natural tendency for a human being to go out, make more connections, to do the right humanity. The only reason we are evil, or the only reason at mind and body level we do evil things, is because we are weaker. We find that lack of something in our life. And to complete that, that's why we do those evil things. But if you are contented, doesn't matter what you have, at body and mind level, doesn't matter what you have. You may not have the perfect body. You may not have the perfect mind. You may not have the perfect money. You may not have the perfect wife or husband. Doesn't matter what you have at body and mind level. But as long as you are identified with your true Brahman nature, which is never born, never changing, non-divisible, never dying, and all that, it just basically makes you so strong that you will just completely become a true human, which we are all meant to become. Sorry, I took a little longer, but this is how I basically was able to satisfy my son. And he was satisfied, actually. He was very happy. So thank you.
It's okay, you know, so the main thing is, the bottom line is that once we are on a spiritual journey towards that divinity, then slowly the evil will drop off anyway. So if the evil is in the mind, so, you know. So
that exactly.
But in general, what I think, according to most of us, this too, any thought or action, if it hurts anybody else,
right,
is kind of evil.
That is against dharma. Again,
see, that's kind of
is to spread love and compassion all around you. Exactly. And the more selfish we are, the more evil we are. You know, that's the bottom line. You know, you can
hurting see anybody in thought or action.
Right.
That's part of evil.
Yes, true. Yes.
Thank you, Shashi. All right. Any other questions or comments?
I know you have your Navaratri.
Oh, Navaratri. Yeah. I'm glad you reminded me. So Navaratri is a 9-day festival that we have coming up. It's going to start on the 17th and it's going to end on the 25th. This year it's 9 days. Normally it goes on 10th day. And Springfield community is going to do their things on the 9th day. It's on the 25th, not 26th. Nancy, I had mentioned 26th, but it's going to be on 25th. When Springfield community will have some function. I mean, there'll be the puja by the priest first, and then after that, there'll be some chanting of bhajans, which is devotional chanting. There will be some philosophical talk by Dr. Vemana and maybe Dr. Naravetla. And then we will have a dance by Vijaya. We'll have some, we have kids who are preparing some skits. So they will be doing that. Yeah, that's very joyful to see the kids, you know, dressed up as, you know, the scriptural characters, and then, you know, doing some actions on that. So there'll be a lot of cultural activities along with the puja. So I can share the link with you when it's available. And, you know, anybody who wants to see, it will be done on Zoom. So with the priest doing the actual worship inside the temple, and we'll be all on the Zoom with that. So I'll share that link with you when it's available. Anybody else? Well, we have 7:41 now, so we're good. If nobody else has any questions, we can always end the meeting. Nancy, whatever you say.
I want to thank you for all the work that you put into this, and I thought that was a beautiful video of your Hindu temple, and it really explained things so well. And we are recording this program, so it will be available for the people that weren't able to come. So just thank you, Dr. Khanna, and to the Hindu community for preparing that virtual tour, because we really wanted to be there tonight. You know, that was our original plan, was to visit all the places of worship. And so that was the next best thing to being there. And I just thought the young man who was explaining things did such a great job. So tell him.
Yeah, he's a wonderful person. You can see he's a good actor. He's the one who produced it. I worked with him to write the script so that we include all the Hindu scriptural values and stuff. But he's the one who did all the acting and show, produced that. His production was beautiful. We all were very happy. The outcome of that video came out very good. It's on the YouTube. So anybody who want to watch it again sometime, it's on available on the YouTube.
That's on YouTube. Yeah. So that was really great. And I thought you did a great job explaining things. And I also want to say with our Global Education Speaker Series, next month we'll be visiting with the Baha community, and Kayvon Nazad, one of our other members, will be speaking. And then in December, we'll be visiting the Jewish temple. So we invite you to come back. It's always on the second Thursday. And if you're not a member of the Global Education Group, if you email me, I can give you the links for that. But again, I just want to say thank you. Is there anybody else that wanted to make any comments?
I want to make a special thank you to Mr. and Mrs. Krieger. You know, their son and my son went to the school together, and we have a long co-association, and so happy to see you. And I'm glad that you survived this 1.5 hour of talk, which I'm sure some of this was kind of a difficult to go. You know, it's hard. Even for Hindus to understand the Hinduism is difficult. So thank you for, staying on.
Good job, Faisal. Good job.
Thank you very much. Okay, well.
Thank you.
Thanks, Arun, for coming, and everybody else, please. So, all right.
I think the best way to get answers or probe Hinduism is so what? I think I like my son's approach. he always challenges me with so what, but then I have to think hard to answer his anxiety and curiosity to know. And that's how I learned quite a bit, actually.
Okay. Thank you, Nancy.
Thank you for joining us for this Global Education and Peace Network Speaker Series with Dr. Ravi Khanna. I want to invite you to come back next month to hear about Baha'i connections with Dr. Nazad, our local dentist and member of our Global Education and Peace Network. That program will also be held on Zoom at 6:30 on Thursday, November 12th. You can email me at nflinchbaugh@springfieldohio.gov. for the Zoom link for the program. Also, I encourage you to visit our website at springfieldohio.gov/globaleducation to find our full calendar and also a one-page sheet of our speakers for the year. And we hope you'll join us every month to hear about our different faith traditions in Springfield and Clark County. I would like to ask you to join us in thanking our sponsors who contribute to help the work of the Global Education and Peace Network. This year, we didn't print the calendar. We hope to do so again next year. Also, during the month of October, November, and December, I invite you to participate in Culture Read, to read a book about anti-racism. Visit our website at springfieldohio.gov/culturefest for more information on this program and how you can get involved. Our Clark County Library has the books available for checkout, and there also are groups discussing each of them. So thank you again for joining us for Hindu Connections with Dr. Ravi Khanna. Hope you have a good day.